Pochette Audio presents A Terrible Thing to Waste: Environmental Racism and Its Assault on the American Mind. Written by Harriet A. Washington. Read by Ron Butler. Introduction. IQ matters. Nature has color-coded groups of individuals so that statistically reliable predictions of their adaptability to intellectually rewarding and effective lives can easily be made. William Shockley, Models, Mathematics, and the Moral Obligation to Diagnose the Origin of Negro IQ Deficits, Review of Educational Research. Long before William Shockley's 1971 assertion that the intelligence of Americans is innate, inherited, and permanently stratified by race, the 19th century scientists known as the American School of Ethnology had trumpeted the same belief, sans statistics. Their assertions were preceded by a long, data-free history of speculation by Europeans on the lower intelligence of Africans and their descendants, speculation that had traditionally supplied a rationale for enslavement. The question of whether innate differences in intelligence exist between blacks and whites goes back more than 1,000 years, to the time when the Moors invaded Europe. Although we focus on European claims that Africans and their descendants are relatively unintelligent, some people of the African diaspora, including the scientifically adept and accomplished Moors, have returned the favor. As Richard E. Nisbet, author of Intelligence and How to Get It, Why Schools and Cultures Count, writes, the Moors speculated that Europeans might be congenitally incapable of abstract thought. But no Moors practiced science in the United States, and in 1840, the government falsified census data to support enslavement with the spurious claim that slaves enjoyed much better mental health than freedmen. Thereafter, freedom was held to be detrimental to African Americans' mental health. In 1981, Stephen Jay Gould's The Mismeasure of Man documented the long history of painstaking but rigged data collection and analysis enlisted to support the cherished belief in the innate intellectual inferiority of blacks. So too, have Even the Rat Was White, first published in 1976 by the late psychologist Robert V. Guthrie, as well as a slew of more recent works. Today, the hereditarian agenda still drives fevered debate about intelligence, or to be more precise, about IQ. Accusations of racism and political correctness fly in reaction to each provocative new publication on race and IQ. The headlines, and too much of the scientific discourse, dwell on the 15-point gap between the average scores of U.S. whites and African Americans. Much hand-wringing ensues. What can be done? Are interventions futile? In the end, this very public and very political drama drives a false perception of genetics as the chief factor determining IQ. And the sniping between hereditarians and their critics has accomplished nothing except a great deal of harping on the prohibitive expense and futility of intervening to close the gap. After all, hereditarians argue, nothing can be done to correct the innate, genetically dictated, lower IQ status of African Americans. In tones of infinite regret, their screeds and interviews insist that devoting resources to closing it would be a quixotic and irresponsibly expensive task. The racial IQ gap is impervious to treatment and here to stay. This bleak prospect is not supported by the facts. Salt of the Earth. Consider that in 1924, the United States closed another 15-point IQ gap with a single, cheap step. We added iodine to salt. The government didn't set out to increase IQ. That was a happy accident. The consequence of a program intended to address nutritional deficiency diseases, chiefly goiters, that are caused by insufficient iodine in the diet. Before 1920, whether or not your diet contained sufficient iodine depended largely on where your water came from. Seawater, for instance, is rich in iodine, which is fortunate for countries like Japan, which has some of the world's most iodine-rich water, and boasts one of the world's highest average IQs. But in a place like Michigan, where the natural water supply was largely runoff from iodine-free glaciers, much of the water and soil in which vegetables grew lacked iodine. This deficiency heightened the rates of goiter, an enlarged thyroid that causes an unsightly lump in the neck. Goiters are rarely life-threatening, but some require medication or surgery. For just a few dollars a ton, adding iodine to salt, in the form of potassium iodide, greatly lowered the incidence of deficiency and goiters. But during World War II, when a new crop of Air Force recruits was tested with the Army General Classification Test, scientists noticed a pattern. Men from low iodine areas who showed improved thyroid health also scored substantially higher on the intelligence test. It turns out that iodine deficiency is an unrecognized cause of mental retardation, especially, but not exclusively, in unborn children. Now we know that iodine bolsters healthy brain development because it is an essential component of thyroid hormone, which helps to direct the complex development of the fetal brain. Yet iodine deficiency remains the world's leading cause of preventable mental retardation. Prenatal iodine deficiency, as well as deficiency in adulthood, leads to compromised intelligence as measured by IQ testing, especially in the developing nations that report some of the world's lowest IQ scores. In 2007, Kul Gautam, the deputy executive director of UNICEF, announced, "Today, over 1 billion people in the world suffer from iodine deficiency, and 38 million babies born every year are not protected from brain damage due to IDD. Almost one-third of the world's population has too little iodine in its diet. And the problem isn't limited to developing countries. In Europe, iodized salt is still not the norm. Moreover, the health-conscious trend toward reducing salt intake has lowered iodine intake as well. So has the gourmet penchant for natural sea salt, which does not contain iodine. Within the United States, African Americans suffer the nation's highest level of iodine deficiency. According to the government's National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, NHANES, data for 2005 to 2008, African Americans' urinary iodine reading of 137 micrograms per liter is lower than that of Mexican Americans at 174 micrograms per liter and of non-Hispanic whites at 168 micrograms per liter. No separate data are given for Native Americans or other ethnic groups. Today, nearly a century after iodine's effects on the brain were first discovered, a wealth of contemporary studies warns of many other environmental factors that, like iodine, dramatically affect intelligence and IQ. These range from lead, which recently made national headlines for contaminating the drinking water in Flint, Michigan, to other poisonous metals such as arsenic and mercury, which often accompany lead and commonly poison reservation lands. Unsurprisingly, the deleterious effects of chemicals in the environment have been most widely reported when they impact white, relatively affluent communities. In the 1980s, for instance, headlines frequently updated us on the struggles of communities like Love Canal in Niagara Falls, New York, where a 70-acre landfill spewed pollution that threatened the health of hundreds. But we never read about Anniston. Saving Anniston. I first heard about Anniston, Alabama, during a chance encounter in the heart of New York City. In 2005, I spent most weekdays at the New York Public Library's iconic Stephen A. Schwarzman building at the corner of 42nd Street and 5th Avenue. One March day, I had tired of writing and emerged from the library around 3 o'clock, in plenty of time to beat the rush hour traffic back to my home in Spanish Harlem. As I joined the queue for the bus, I stole a peek at my BlackBerry, where sad news awaited. Johnny Cochran had died. Almost immediately, a 70-ish African-American man joined the line behind me. He was thin, looked a bit frail, and wore an immaculate but slightly faded trench coat, a black fedora, and an expression of care and pain. As the bus arrived, he slowly mounted the steps behind me, sighing lightly. As I twisted around to make sure he was all right, he looked up and asked, "You heard about Johnny Cochran?" "Yes," I said as gently as I could. "It's a great loss." The man shook his head sadly and continued his ascent. Another man murmured something to him, and though I didn't catch the words, I understood the tone. This sadness was felt by many people, some of whom didn't care a fig about the exoneration Cochran had won for O.J. Simpson in 1995.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.